The Warblers podcast is proudly brought to you by Birds Canada, a charitable organization dedicated to protecting birds and their habitats. But we cannot do it alone. Our work relies on the generosity of caring bird enthusiasts like you. Your donation today supports this podcast, as well as many of the projects and birds we discuss, like the whippoorwills that you're about to hear about. And here's a bonus. When you donate any amount right now, you'll be eligible to join Project Feeder Watch. If you caught our previous episode, you know how exciting it is to become part of the Citizen Science Program. So head to birdscanada.org/give or follow the link in our show notes to make a donation today. We're going to roll that theme music now, but that'll give you a second to go make that donation. From Birds Canada, this is The Warblers. This is The Wake Up Call, a special podcast series from The Warblers by Birds Canada. I'm Andrea Gress. Join me as I speak with experts about our most threatened bird species, why these species are at risk, and what conservation actions are being taken. And finally, what we can all do to help. Welcome to another episode of The Warblers. Today, we've got a wake-up call for you. Longtime listeners will be familiar with these. These episodes take a deeper dive into a specific species at risk in Canada. And today's wonderful species is the eastern whippoorwill. Often these episodes focus on the things we already know about a particular species, and we rarely get any insights into how we know those things. So today's episode is a bit of a treat. We'll still learn all the usual things, what eastern whippoorwills look like, where they're found, and the threats and challenges to their population. But we'll also get some unique insights from researchers who are actively studying whippoorwills. They'll help us understand some of the work that goes on behind the scenes so that we can learn more about a species at risk and ultimately be better at helping their populations recover. So without further ado, let's dive into it. Welcome to the podcast, guys. I'm so excited to have not one, but three whippoorwill nerds with me today. I'm going to start by getting you each to introduce yourself. Natasha, do you mind going first?
Hello, I'm Natasha Barlow. I'm a projects biologist with Birds Canada in Ontario, where I coordinate various field-based research projects. I also run some citizen science monitoring programs and advocate for positive change for aerial insectivores, which are our swifts, our swallows, our nightjars, spoiler, spoiler, and flycatchers, which awesome. Are basically birds, the birds that fly around, catch flying insects. Excited to be back.
Well, Victoria, tell us a bit about yourself.
So my name is Victoria Pepe, and I am a master's student in Dr. Liam McGuire's lab at the University of Waterloo, and I am studying the habitat selection of the eastern whippoorwill.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And Lauren, over to you.
I am Lauren Weeks. I'm also a master's student in the McGuire lab at the University of Waterloo. Victoria and I are partners in crime, and I study the preferred diet and migration movement of the eastern whippoorwill.
So let's start with the basics, the important stuff. Lauren, could you describe what an eastern whippoorwill looks and sounds like?
Yeah, for sure. So they're medium-sized birds weighing about 50 grams, which is about the same weight as a lemon. They're mostly all fluff and wing, though. So their length is about 10 inches, which is the long side of a piece of paper. They are really hard to see, so they look more brown and gray, which allows them to blend in with the floor, so like leaf litter on the ground, or the bark of a tree if they're perched in the tree. They sound really cool. So they're actually known for saying their name. It sounds like whippoorwill. And they've been known to say their name over 1,000 times in a row, which is super crazy. What? I know. So this combination with what they look and sound like makes them super easy to hear, but really hard to see.
Oh, so they just love themselves. They're out in the forest just shouting about themselves all night long, hey?
Yeah.
Pretty cool. And they are nocturnal. So harder to see. People are more likely to hear them, right?
Yeah, for sure. So they're active at night. But more accurately, they're known as crepuscular, which is just a fancy way of saying they're active at dawn and dusk specifically. And I would say that it would be like pretty hard for someone to just randomly come across one, but you're definitely more likely to hear them singing.
Oh, especially if it goes for so long. Yeah. Could you describe their mouth bill a little bit for folks?
So they have these like super tiny bills. They don't stick out very far from their face. But then when they open up their mouth to catch an insect, it's like 2 inches wide, which then makes it super easy for them to catch them in flight and makes them super efficient hunters.
It's wild. They look to me like a puppet.
I know, or like a little dragon.
Oh, the dragon. That's cute. And then they're kind of like, okay, I'm going to just go ridiculous with this. They're like dragon whales of the sky, because they're kind of just like opening their mouths and catching, right? Like, take that to the research people. I mean, you guys are the right ones. Dragon whales of the sky. Get it in print.
Publish it.
All right. Thanks for that. Victoria, could you help us figure out like where in Canada these birds are found?
So we can find them usually kind of central Saskatchewan, and they go all the way to Nova Scotia. They breed in much of southwestern Ontario, which is where we do our work, but they can also breed as far north as Lake Superior. They, as we mentioned, are migratory species. So they travel south in the winter, or sorry, in the autumn months, around September, October, to their overwintering grounds, which can be found around southeast edge of the U.S. And some actually decide to stay in Florida in the winter. So I like to call them true snowbirds. Others also travel to Veracruz, Mexico, and Central America. Our population specifically goes to Veracruz and Florida.
And I mean, they're hard to see. So is that largely through MODIS tagging that we have this information?
Yeah, exactly. So we use MODIS, which is a wildlife tracking system, and we attach radio transmitters to them. There's towers across all of North America, and using these towers, when the bird passes by them, they're picked up, and it lets us know where the individual was and when it was there.
Cool. Very, very cool information. Okay, Natasha, on to you. Does the term goat sucker mean anything to you?
Oh boy. So absolutely. So when nightjars, which is this group of birds we're talking about, that eastern whippoorwills and other species folks might be familiar with, like common nighthawks, when they are originally classified, if you have old field guides, you'd see them under the name goat suckers. And it's from this historical belief that they milked goats at night.
What?
But true to that aerial insectivore name, they in fact do not milk goats at night. They eat insects, but they do have this wide mouth. And so that's kind of where that belief came from.
That sounds absolutely bizarre. I can't believe that's where that name came from.
Yeah. And then night jars comes from, they make jarring noises at night. So night jar.
Okay.
But I think they're a lovely song. So sorry to everyone who lives in the woods.
so bizarre. So, and like night jars, goat suckers, same thing.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you have common poorwills, eastern whippoorwills, common nighthawks in Canada, all classified as night jars or goat suckers.
If you're really looking for a good name. Yeah. Okay. They've got to be the most uniquely named birds out there. So, Natasha, you've mentioned to me before that one of the challenges with this species is data deficiency, that they're really hard to monitor. Do we actually know what their population is?
Yeah. So going back to kind of what Lauren was saying, for all actually of the listeners, I would be really interested to know who has actually seen or heard an eastern whippoorwill. And I expect the percentage is probably not necessarily high. They are relatively cryptic species. They are these crepuscular species. And in fact, in the last Ontario Breeding Bird Atlas, which happened about 20 years ago, which is a 5-year program to map the distribution and abundance of Ontario's breeding birds, during that last atlas, it was recognized that nightjars, like this eastern whippoorwill, are notoriously a little bit more difficult to survey appropriately than many of our other breeding birds. And so in this current atlas, which is ongoing until next season, there are specialized survey protocols that have been created specifically for the nightjars, so we can get a better sense of their population. But in general, they are part of that aerial insectivore group. And from the State of Canada's Birds Report, and as we've known for a while, that group as a whole isn't necessarily doing the greatest. And eastern whippoorwill in particular are one of those species that has experienced population declines. And so the best population trends that we have, they do show steeper declines from about the 1980s to 2005 in southern Ontario and Quebec in comparison to the other populations, but with some, I would say, cautious recent trend data. Again, these species aren't as easy to survey, but the rate of population declines may have slowed since about 2005, and more recent years actually show some level of stabilization, but they absolutely do still need intentional conservation efforts due to ongoing threats. And this species is still very much at risk of becoming more threatened and losing even more individuals as time goes on if those threats aren't lessened.
Right. So this is a species that maybe is improving in some areas, but they're far from, you know, being in a safe zone. So we still need to really help them out.
Yeah, as many of our aerial insectivores that have experienced those declines, the populations aren't necessarily what they were back in the 1970s or 80s, but hopefully we can get there one day.
Yeah, it's not just a dark, dark lost cause. We can work on this together. So what are the main threats to the eastern whippoorwill?
So as with many aerial insectivores and other species as well, there are often many threats, but for eastern whippoorwill in particular, two primary threats are habitat loss and modification of that kind of early successional forest and edge with open patch habitat on the breeding grounds, as well as loss of their insect food. Again, these are these nocturnal crepuscular predators. They fly around, they catch insects. And so they're doing this not only for themselves, but also for raising their babies and raising their young. And so those two primary threats are the ones that we're focusing on primarily.
Okay, cool. Victoria, Natasha's kind of mentioned that habitat decline, it's one of the threats that we're dealing with, and you are studying whippoorwill nesting locations. So I'm keen to hear some of your thoughts on this. But first, could you describe what a nest site looks like?
Absolutely. Their nests are quite hilarious in the aspect that they don't really create a nest. So the females will find some sort of good-looking decaying leaf litter, and they will pop 1 to 2 eggs on top of that, and that is it.
Oh my gosh. But I mean, they're really camouflaged, so if they're sitting on those eggs, it's going to be hard for someone to see them. But I've seen photos of the nests, and the eggs themselves are pretty, like, they're white, right?
Absolutely. The eggs are mainly white with a little bit of beige speckling to them. So the eggs themselves aren't super well camouflaged to the ground, but as soon as the adult sits on those eggs, they disappear.
Okay. Yeah. And how do you study a nest site? Like, what kind of data are you collecting and how are you doing that?
Well, first we have to find the nests, which is oh, so much fun. We go out at nighttime and we have our headlamps on. And using our headlamps, we look for a red eye shine that whippoorwills reflect off of our lights. So we're basically rummaging through the forest and looking for this red eye shine. We found 7 nests over our last field season, which was awesome. Once those birds fledge from the nest, we go back to them during the daytime and we look at fine scale characteristics of the nest site. So things such as ground cover, percentage of leaf litter, the tree and shrub species nearby, if there's any alive or dead tree and shrub species. We're just trying to find exactly what kind of things that they're selecting for at a minute scale to be able to hopefully inform landowners and conservation managers what they can do to help create this kind of optimal nest site space for the whippoorwills.
Okay, yeah. That sounds kind of spooky, going out in the night looking for a red eye shine off in the distance. Like,
yeah, it's a little bit spooky. You know what? It's funny because at first it's definitely a little bit nerve-wracking, like, you know, being out in the night in the forest, but you kind of get used to it. Like, we were out there for 3 months, and there's some sort of quietness at night that's actually very relaxing.
Okay, yeah. And did you see anything else, like come across, I don't know, coyotes or anything else in the night?
We didn't see much. You know, sometimes you'd see the odd white-tailed deer. We definitely heard a lot of things, lots of owls, screech owls nearby. And we have heard foxes screaming, which is awesome to hear at nighttime.
Spooky though.
Yeah. Very, very spooky. But yes, you see, you mainly hear more than you do see at nighttime for sure.
Great. This should have been a Halloween episode. What an interesting style of field work. Did you know bird-friendly coffee farms act as functioning ecosystems? A diverse variety of native trees plus the shade attracts ample insects, which further attracts the birds. The diversity of native plants is just one factor that puts bird-friendly certified coffee a step ahead of coffee that is simply shade-grown. Try coffee from Birds and Beans today. Orders over $45 get free shipping. Plus, if you use the code WARBLERS when checking out, they'll donate a portion of the sale to Birds Canada to support this podcast and bird conservation here in Canada. So could you tell me, what is it about their habitat requirements that makes them so vulnerable to habitat loss?
Yeah, so they require what we call edge habitat. So what that usually is a dense forest that they use for nesting and roosting during the daytime. But also next to that dense forest, they look for open areas like meadows for foraging. And due to the increase of agricultural practices, urbanization, things like that, it's causing a decline in their suitable habitats. So as well as they look for early successional forests as well. They look for forests that have, you know, smaller trees, earlier life stages, and just simply letting the forests go past that early successional stage kind of puts them at this risk of not having proper habitat to nest in.
Really niche, specific things that they're looking for.
Absolutely.
And you kind of mentioned that with your research, you're hoping to help land managers, property owners, you know, create better habitat. Are there other questions that you're hoping to answer with your research?
Yeah, actually. So I also look at the home range habitat of the whippoorwill. So using the MODIS technology that I previously mentioned, we attach radio transmitters to individual birds. And each radio transmitter has a unique code associated with it, which allows us to track those individuals of the population. So again, here we are out in the middle of the night, and we use receivers that pick up the radio transmitter emissions, and we try to track their home range. So we would go out every single night when suitable and try and track specific birds. So actually, over 2024 field season, we tracked 13 birds and gained a total of 410 points.
Wow.
Yeah.
That seems like a lot of data to go through.
Yeah. So we haven't gotten to that stage yet of actually analyzing the data, but I'm really looking forward to seeing, you know, if there's any overlap between the home ranges. If there is overlap, you know, how big is that overlap? There's also lacking data on breeding home range in whippoorwills as well. There's some stuff about their overwintering grounds, but there isn't really truly that much information on how big their home ranges may be. So using that as well, I also hope to inform landowners, you know, how much space or area they may need to support a healthy population of eastern whippoorwills.
Cool. That sounds like really interesting research overall. I think you're going to have a lot of interesting findings.
I hope so. I sure do.
Yeah. Yeah. And Lauren, your research looks at a different angle, one of my favorite subjects, food. So firstly, could you tell us what's the main food source for the eastern whippoorwill?
Yeah, so the eastern whippoorwills are aerial insectivores, as mentioned before. So that means that they catch bugs mid-flight. So they like to perch and then wait for a bug to fly by. And then they use the illumination from the moon to see the bug. And then they fly out, catch it, and then fly back to their perch where they munch on it. So right now, all we really know is that they like flying insects, specifically moths and beetles, but we don't know which ones. So that's where my project comes in. I'm hoping to figure out exactly what species they're eating.
And like we've said, they're small, elusive, nocturnal birds. How do you actually study what they're eating?
So unfortunately, we can't stand there and annoy the birds and just observe all of the bugs that they catch. So we actually have to observe what comes out of the birds. So we take fecal samples from the birds. When we catch them, we put them in a little bag and let them rest for a few minutes. And then usually they generously provide us with a fecal sample.
Oh, so kind.
I know. And then we collect the poop samples from their nests as well. And then we're hoping to genetically sequence those, which would provide us with a complete list of everything that they've eaten.
Wow.
I know.
That sounds very cool. Now, we often hear about how aerial insectivores are under threat because of changes to their food sources. I'm hoping you could expand on that a little bit and explain like how exactly that's a threat to the whippoorwills.
Yeah, so as Natasha and Victoria mentioned, the use of pesticides and losing habitat to developing land for agriculture and housing has resulted in drastic reductions in insect populations. And this has a huge negative impact on the birds that use these insects for prey. Without food, how are you supposed to live? So if the insects continue to disappear, the birds will have a harder and harder time finding food. So that's why we're hoping to be able to support the whippoorwill populations by determining exactly what they're eating.
Yeah, yeah. These big dragon whales of the sky need some bugs to munch on. Super important. What are the other main questions that you're hoping to answer with your research?
So I'm hoping to determine exactly what they're eating, but I'd also like to go further than that and determine what host plants are supporting these insect populations. So if we can determine what host plants support the insects, we can then plant more of those and then support the insects, which then support the whippoorwills. This information could be used for conservation efforts along with just the general public or people that want to plant cool plants at home to support a bird in the woods. And then I'm also looking into the migration movement in the birds using the MODIS tags that Victoria talked about. So I get to watch them fly all the way down to Mexico and Florida and then overwinter there and then see which routes they take back, where they stop, how long it takes them, and all those fun details.
And I love how tangible of a solution that could lead to if we know what kinds of plants the bugs are going to be attracted by, that can lead to better food sources for whippoorwills. Kind of like how, I mean, people plant milkweed specifically to attract monarchs. You know, it's just like a tangible conservation solution. That sounds like such a great thing to focus in on.
Exactly.
Now, we've heard a lot of really interesting facts about these birds so far, but I know they're little weirdos, and I know you guys love this species, so I'm excited to hear if there's anything we've missed. Or if we've already covered your favorite facts, I'm wondering if you could maybe share like a favorite moment you've had working with them in the field. Victoria, do you mind starting this one out for us?
Absolutely. And as you previously said, this should have been a Halloween episode because my favorite fact has to do with whippoorwills being called a bad omen.
Oh.
So back in the day, they used to think that a whippoorwill singing by your window would mean impending death.
Oh, gosh. Between that and the goatsucker name, like these guys have a bad image, hey?
They really do, but quite honestly, they are such docile creatures. When we capture them to attach the radio transmitters, they just sit there. Like they don't really, they definitely don't bite, and they just kind of accept their fate, and we attach the radio transmitters and let them go on their way. So I think that, you know, this view of them being these crazy goat sucking bad omens is quite hilarious, because it's absolutely not what they are.
Yeah, they're gentle, beautiful creatures of the night. Lauren, what about you? A favorite fact or story for us?
Well, my favorite physical fact about the whippoorwills is the size of their mouth, which I already touched on. I just think it's so crazy how their mouth opens to be a fifth of the size of their body. But that might just be because I study their diet, so I think that's really cool. But,
no, it's cool. Anyone can look at a photo and be mind blown.
Yeah, there's some crazy photos on the internet. But my favorite moment from the field would be my last night. It was actually a meteor shower happening that night. And I was just walking down the path trying to track one of our birds. And then a male flew past me and another male flew by and they were chasing each other. And they just like went right around me and then up into the trees as the like shooting stars were going by. And it was such a peaceful and like just great ending to the whole field season. It was awesome.
Magical. Yeah. Oh, that sounds so lovely. Natasha, what about you?
Okay, so this was not at all planned, but I am also going to be talking about cool astronomical events.
Okay.
So this year, there's been so many cool events, right? Mm-hmm. There's reaching the solar maximum with northern light shows galore, or there's Comet A3, or there's the April solar eclipse here in North America. And so I wanted to add learning about eastern whippoorwills to that list. They're moon birds, if you haven't really picked up on that yet. And there is, I would say, some evidence to suggest that they lay their eggs to be timed to the moon phases, with hatching occurring before that full moon, so the adults can use the illumination of the moon to forage for insects for their young, which I think is really cool. And then actually some recent publications from Ellie Knight, Kevin Hanna, and Jonathan Damore, they noted that moon altitude, so how high the moon is in the sky, has a positive effect on detecting these birds. So as we're appreciating these celestial bodies like the sun or comets or moons or even meteor showers, I think it's cool to appreciate species like eastern whippoorwill, who have an association to these really cool celestial bodies as well.
That's super interesting. Yeah, I mean, you mentioned that they can be found in Saskatchewan earlier in the episode here, and I was back in Saskatchewan for one of the best northern lights nights that I've seen in years.
Amazing.
I wonder if those whippoorwills were just having a feast that night, able to see so clearly what was going on.
It's funny you say that, because one of our main technicians who works with us, he was out during the aurora that happened in May and texted me and was saying how the eastern whippoorwills were just popping off. They were just singing so much. They were lighting up the sky with their song. And I just think they're such a cool, ethereal bird.
Oh, that's just so lovely. So these guys, they've got a bad rep. They're seen as spooky, goat sucker, omens of death. But I'm hearing that is the exact opposite of what they are. They are absolutely just delights to come across in the evening hours. And now that everybody absolutely loves the species, Natasha, how can listeners help the eastern whippoorwill?
Yeah, so even though probably from this episode, they might not seem the most accessible to everyone, but one of the things that I think is important to remember for all migratory species, not just the eastern whippoorwill, is that it's not just where they breed that matters. I use this example a lot, but if I was walking from Veracruz, you know, where some of these birds are going, along the Gulf of Mexico to Long Point in Ontario, I would probably hope for a lot of food, a lot of water, some shelter, hopefully some good weather, because that's a really long journey. And one of the things I find that's really empowering for really any conservation movement, but also very much for species like our migratory species, is how connected places are across the globe. And so by gardening for birds, which was kind of touched on in Lauren's talk, of course, I'm going to mention birdgardens.ca,
yes.
But creating that space at your home that helps provide that habitat for resident and migratory birds, I think is a really good start. And then also taking that to a bigger scale of working to protect these landscapes and different habitats across the life cycle. Because at our study sites that Victoria mentioned in Southern Ontario, on the breeding grounds, we have a regenerating oak savanna type habitat that the Nature Conservancy of Canada and private landowners like Prairie Song Nursery have created and maintained, where eastern whippoorwills forage. And that's adjacent to these forest tracts with oaks and cherries and young ash, which creates that nice leaf litter that they lay their eggs on. And so maintaining and really creating and protecting, but also advocating for these spaces is really crucial for this long-term population persistence. And another option, I would say, is reducing the use of non-specific pesticides when possible on your own property, but also really advocating for that change and accountability at higher levels of government, because pesticides obviously have a role to play when it comes to food security, but they also have a major role to play when it comes to being responsible in their use and production. And we and many of our wildlife species are seeing the consequences there. And then the last thing I would say is you can also just donate your skills and your time. If you're a bird watcher, you can volunteer for the Breeding Bird Survey in Canada or the United States to help monitor bird populations over time, which supports a primary source of data for population trends, including the new State of Canada's Birds Report. You can volunteer for local breeding bird atlases or the Canadian Nightjar Survey, or you can even just follow along with the Global Nightjar Network. That's a great way to learn about nightjars across the world, not just in Canada or the United States. And also just the cool work that's being done to really understand and conserve these really amazing birds.
Thanks, Natasha. That is such a great list, from, you know, individual actions to larger scale advocacy. There are really a ton of ways that listeners can help whippoorwills. I love to hear that. Thanks for tuning in to another great Wake Up Call episode. I hope you enjoyed learning about the elusive eastern whippoorwill as much as I did. Lauren and Victoria's master's projects are part of a collaboration between Birds Canada and the University of Waterloo. Let us know if you liked hearing about research that's actively happening. Although we don't have the results yet, I personally find some of the work that goes into getting scientific results can be just as fascinating. And it also perhaps offers some insights and inspiration to those of you who are just starting to build careers in the world of birds. Lots of great projects were mentioned, of course, in this episode. We will link to those in the episode description, including things like the Global Nightjar Network and the Breeding Bird Survey and the Canadian Nightjar Survey. Fantastic ways for you to get out and get involved with whippoorwills. The Warblers is a podcast of Birds Canada. Our goal is to bring you the information you need to discover, enjoy, and protect birds. If you like what you hear, please subscribe, leave a review, and share this podcast with everyone you know. Birds Canada relies on the support of donors like you. Visit birdscanada.org/warblerspodcast to make a donation today. The Warblers is produced by Jody Allaire, Kate Dogleash, Chris Koo, and Andrea Gress, with music by Jose Mora and art by Alex Nickel. Until next time, keep birding.